Dear ladies and gentlemen, I'm very glad to meet you in this nice conference, and I thank the organizers that they give us the opportunity to exchange that way, even if the technical conditions are a little complicated. My name is Astrid Schneidewind. I'm working for the Jülich Center of Neutron Science at the Heinz Meyer Leibniz Center in Garching, operating this nice neutron three-axis spectrometer. And scientifically, I'm mainly interested in exotic magnetic ground states, in unconventional superconductors, or also in the exchange of magnetic, or in the interaction of magnetic and magnetic excitations and lattice dynamics. But here I will speak about the data infrastructure for diversified user operation in neutron and photon science within the proposed DAFNE project. And this I will do as the elected chair of the German Committee Research with Neutrons, which represents the neutron user community in Germany and partially in Europe. And we, together with the related association of the photon science, applied for the DAFNE project within the call of the German National Research Data Infrastructure. As tax-paid scientists, we are all requested to propose, provide, and to identify the best materials of the needs of the society. And for sure, there are thousands of known and also newly synthesized materials, and they have thousands of materials properties, which are investigated by experimental and theoretical methods. The theory in this way does not only explain the experimental result, they also develop models and propose properties by extending their knowledge and modeling in advanced ways. From the experimental point of view, we have hundreds of different methods about materials properties, which again are provided by hundreds of different experimental stations and equipments, which are partially commercially provided and therefore bring their own data formats and possibly also software for analysis with. Or they are self-made at the universities, which brings the same problem about data formats and analysis with. But at the end, all these information are stored in databases from both sides, theory and experiments. And there is a try to have material databases to make a systematic approach to compare properties or to find information from the people who didn't measure themselves these properties to improve the access to the available data. From the theoretical point of view, there is a new development due to the strong development of technical opportunities. Algorithms are available for building hypothetical materials, which are also stored in databases as well as the results of the theoretical models. And for sure, there is a need to decide which of these hypothetical models will be synthesized and measured. And I learned it's quite difficult to find this decision. So there is a strong request to exchange the data and the information between all of the partners within materials research to exchange information, to make information available and readable for others, to fasten up all this process of materials development and improve the procedures. And for sure, this shall not be done only on an individual way or some kind of manual way. We also want to do this using all the digital technologies in automated way to exchange information between the different kinds of material databases. And we all know that there is a glue to do that in an efficient way, which means to agree about metadata standards, that we can read the information from the others by knowing about keywords which provide what is stored and what does the different data mean. And in our days, also this shall not be done only in some manual or individual way. We also want to use the digital techniques to do this exchange of information and reading the databases in some automated or self-reading way. Where are we now? We provide with neutrons and synchrotron sources two probes, but with a quite large number of different techniques for the different needs of the users, since our user community is quite diverse with very different expectations and traditions about data and data analysis. And simply to explain that, I show you here the distribution of the beam time in the last years for neutrons at the MLZ, or given from the synchrotron survey of the last year about the different communities who use these sources. And you immediately understand that an archaeologist will have a different access to about the data, what he expects and how he will use it and how the data look like compared to a soft matter scientist, or that the engineers from industrial applications or simply from material science will have a fully different use of data than basic researchers from condensed matter physics, for instance. There's a second point which asks us to improve our data processing and management, and this is the strong increase of amount of data which we can collect within a short time or in the same time by developments of detectors and data collection techniques and scattering techniques. At the moment we are at a number of roughly 5 petabyte per year. This is not only the synchrotrons, but driven by them, but neutrons are following immediately with the new measuring stations. So this this large amount of data is asking for new access about data evaluation and data storage, which brings new challenges with us. So you can see here on this picture that the size of the amount of the data depends from depends from the technique and varies between the different techniques, but the increase is not stopped yet and will probably continue over the next years. So there's a quite big challenge to manage this in a way to make all the output of our facilities efficiently used. And the third point I want to mention here is that not only related but also related to this huge amount of data is that this requests a quick visualization of this data, since our experiments are very often requesting an interaction with the experiment during the measurement. So that means that we want to see what we measure and then change parameters or change the measurement strategy within the experiment, since normally neutron and photon experiments at large scale facilities cannot be repeated. So we need to find a way to analyze the data or pre-analyze the data during the experiment before storing and giving the user an opportunity to see what they measure. And for sure, this large amount of data brings a challenge to store the data and to decide which data are stored in which way. And again, how can they be quickly accessible if they are needed for analysis? All these points show you that there is a strong demand for interaction between the users who know about the use of the data, what is in the data and how can they be analyzed, or what is the scientific content of the data, and the facilities where the data are produced and which are probably requested to find possibilities to store the data and to provide the data to the users. Directly during the experiment for sure, but also after. It's only a small comment to mention that with these large-scale facilities, which are quite rare and expensive, it's not only Germany. We are well connected within Europe between the facilities, and this is also organized in Leaps and Lens, and also between the user communities, and within this quite strong interaction and cooperation for sure, also in data management and processing, there are ongoing projects. So we do not start from scratch. And these projects are also partially funded by European Commission within PANASC and EXPANS and are partially related to the European Open Science Cloud Initiative. Simply to tell you what we are doing and give you a little impression about that, I have a very few examples. Starting from energy materials and quite large samples, bulky samples. I have here lithium-ion batteries, which can be in situ or operando during the charging and discharging, be observed in their whole bulky properties. And by this, we can analyze the lithium distribution within the batteries and can learn about the lithium movement. while charging, while discharging, and this not only in one cycle, but in several cycles, so we can learn what is improving and damaging the properties, and in this way we can contribute to improve the materials for that. On the other size scale, we have the nanomaterials, which are in this case investigated by a synchrotron beam. So within a liquid, they pass the in a liquid flow, they pass the X-ray beam, and this is a trick to get enough statistics to investigate the structure of these nanoparticles. Another example of cooperation between both techniques is they try to exchange the lead in ferroelectrica. Ferroelectrica are materials which are used a lot in robotics and medicine for actuators, or also in loudspeakers, for instance. So it's very often used, but the production of these materials containing lead is quite difficult, and the lead should be exchanged. And here is a study to find alternative materials by exchanging the stoichiometry and learning about the change of properties by exchanging the content of the materials, which was quite successful, and alternative materials could be proposed with neutron and synchrotron measurements. For biology, it's clear that the large molecules of proteins are quickly and efficiently investigated by photons, and a lot of these structures could be observed in the last years. But to understand the function of proteins, for instance, for genes or enzymes or catalysts or also antibiotica, it is needed to know about a single hydrogen at a very special position within this large structure. Or you need to know the angle of a bond which switches the function of an enzyme or a catalyst. Or you need to know if a single iron atom here is oxidized or not. And this is the part which is finally done with neutron scattering. And last but not least, we could observe these extended in real space magnetic structures, which lead to an anomalous Hall effect applying an electrical current. And this opens the door to magnetic materials to be functional materials in IT technology. So there's a quite large diversity in all this use and all these communities which ask us for neutrons. On one side, all of them are facing the challenges of our daily life. And on the other hand, we have the challenges by faster data acquisition, in situ analysis, which needs an increased efficiency and special techniques to manage the data and optimize the data processing and analysis. We want to combine different methods to improve the knowledge in a very quick way. So we want to merge the data from different facilities to have a combined analysis of these data, not only from facilities, also from instruments and on different foci of the technical aspects of the measurements. And we need to serve an analysis of the data from local to quite extended computing. So we need federated and shared data infrastructures. And for sure, we want to make all these available for the application of machine learning, neural networks, and other techniques to work with these big data amounts as requested by users. But for sure, it's our own interest to make use of all the techniques available to improve and make the output of our facilities more efficient. So how does it look like? Today we have the request from the different scientific challenges. They go to the different communities and ask for materials or their properties. And then the scientists from the different sub-communities think about the different methods they want to use for investigation. And in our case, they ask by a proposal at a facility to use special techniques, and then they apply the probes to the sample. In the data life cycles, you can see it here, you need to have a quite extended plan, which includes also the kind of data you want to achieve. And for sure, you also want to think a little bit about the metadata, at least in the way experimental conditions and some information about the sample. Then you perform the experiment and you create the data, including the metadata. And while measuring, you want to visualize the data, you want to have some technique to validate the data, and for sure they need to be stored. And then you come to the analysis, and this very often or in normal way is done by the scientists at home. So they take the data home in some way, analyze them, apply any software tools, and in best way, in best case, they write a paper and the work is done and the data are more or less lost. For sure, we have instrument data, and very often the raw data are saved, but reduced data as well as the analysis itself or simply intermediate data while analysis stay at the users and are not available anymore. And this is for sure nothing what we would say a fair data management. So the goal of our initiative is now to close this cycle, not only to save the data in a better way, but also to curate the data, to improve the decision which data are saved and stored and which can probably either given away or maybe are stored only in reduced way. We want to find ways to have access rules to provide at some time an open access to give everybody the opportunity to use these data. Since with the modern techniques, there is for sure more information in the data than the goal of the current experiment is focusing on. So we expect that there will be a need or a demand to look for with different ideas into the large data space to find additional information, which is immediately the point of reuse. And this at the end will increase the impact of the research. So applying the FAIR principles immediately changes the data management and the processing, but also naturally follows our intention to make better use of our data. So what we want to provide is an infrastructure which directly influences the behavior and the data flow after the idea to perform an experiment, and which is installed between the different instruments and their data flow and the communities which finally make use of the data and give the scientific output of it. So Daphne wants to provide an infrastructure, which means also that we want to care how to fulfill all of our ideas using the technical developments which are already there. So we do not want to develop new techniques. We want to make at least as much as possible use of the things which are developed by others and other communities are simply already available. And in most of the cases, this will, at the state where we are at the moment, be the most efficient and most successful way. So our deep dream about this data processing is driven by the view of scientists. We want to find not only the data and the software tools somewhere, we want to find also our samples back. We want to know where is the sample measured, with which method and which technique. And we want to give opportunity to have a look to related measurements which are done by others, that they do not need to be repeated. So we want to give all this information independently, or we want to provide this information independently of the person who has been at the experiment himself. So all the information needs to be given in a way that everybody can understand what happened. And we want to provide also access to the suitable software tools for the data analysis in case that they are quite advanced and complex. So in the first step, for sure, we want to make sure that this software is user-friendly and easy to use, but we also want to make sure that this software is maintained over longer time scales. And this will be a request to the facilities at the end. Interfaces are for sure needed and to use these catalogs. And I mentioned already, we want to merge the experimental data from different origins as much as possible and as much as useful. And for sure, we want to make the analysis repeatable and provable, even if the software version changed. And for this, we have several steps. We want a big issue is the metadata capture. We want to establish data catalogs and archives. We want to establish the infrastructure for data and software reuse. And for sure, but this is not the last and least step. It's one of the main points to engage the community, to join our efforts. And this means especially to train the PIs, which educate students later, to follow our ideas about for instance, metadata capture and agreement about metadata, which for sure needs a little change of common procedures, which is a little more work at the beginning. So we want to install pilot projects to show the people the added value if the system will work. User-driven means that we need to be in contact with the users who finally use these data. We need to accept the different traditions and working styles, and we also need to accept that for sure metadata, data capture software use and other stuff is different for the different communities, which needs some effort from the facilities to agree about converting or compromises between all these technical standards. Metadata is a big issue. So here you have an example for a data set which contains several different or in a measurement which finally gives several individual data sets which needs to be analyzed individually. And a very, very important point in all these developments is to the establishment of a user logbook, of an electronic logbook, which allows the user to take this electronic logbook going from one facility to the other and make it readable there and make it all compatible there to combine or to correlate the instrumental data as well as the measured data to provide finally the merged analysis. And for sure, there is a request to the users to define what is needed to be recorded and what is really necessary and what can be probably ignored. So there is a modular system needed, where you can switch on and off the special needs of a community or of a technique. And you for sure need to be able to modify the analysis. So you need to combine the different subsets, but you also need to be able to analyze them independently. And here's an example what the photon scientists call metadata. So there is a lot of individual instrument and technical parameters. There's a quite large number of technical possibilities, but as I already said, the user at the end is not interested in the technique behind. The user wants to get an easy to use system. So we need to provide all this technique by making use of experience in other communities, but we do not want to have extra effort for the users in the way that the work becomes more complicated to our initiatives. And my last aspect is the question of metadata. About wording. What do we describe by metadata? It seems to be easy as long as you are in your own community. But the experience shows that it's a quite difficult thing and needs a lot of effort. And again, this is a question where we need all the scientists themselves, especially the PIs, which finally need to teach the students to provide any discipline following our metadata standards. And it's not only the wording of metadata, it starts already in units. Most of you know that the same unit is used in different ways in different subcommunities. And as an experience from the last Fermat workshop, which I attended, I have simply show you the metadata this description from theory provided by a colleague from Berkeley in his talk here. So you see that metadata in theory or computing is what code is used, what is computed, where are the inputs, what does this digit mean, and which units are this, and this is what an experimentalist would show you as metadata subset. This is beam parameters, motor positions, detector calibration, instrument configuration, sample environment, temperature, field, pressure, and so on. So this is a quite big use to agree about this stuff. And with this, I want to thank you all for your attention. Again, thank the organizers. Even if I didn't give so much technical input, I hope that I could give a little understanding how all this stuff is seen from the user side of view. And I'm very happy to exchange the experience about the available techniques, which probably can easily be used, and by this we can fasten up the installation of our infrastructure. So let's join our efforts, let's cooperate, and thank you again.